Welcome, Rotarians and guests, to the Rotary Club of Seattle, the fourth oldest and one of the world's largest Rotary Clubs, where we embrace service above self and are connecting for good. Well, today we're going to tackle two hot topics. It seems to be what I hear in conversations across social media, traditional media. Everywhere I turn, people are saying or asking, what's happening with immigration? And I just saw a great movie. I wonder if it's going to win the Academy Award. So we've got subject matter experts to answer those questions for us today. But first, we're going to get an inspiration from our very inspiring member, Geraldine Brousseau. So Geraldine, inspire us. And then please remain standing because our song leader, Virginia McKenzie, is going to lead us in song, and she's accompanied by Marley Iverson.
Thank you, President Kathy. Fellow Rotarians, in May of 1975, you may remember, Governor Daniel J. Evans welcomed Vietnamese refugees to come to Washington State to make their homes after California, the state of California, refused them entry. Governor Evans asked every state agency to open their doors wide and friends and neighbors to open their doors wide to welcome the Vietnamese people to their new home. In early 1996, citizens from Washington State, including my family, traveled to Vietnam to propose working with the Vietnamese people in a way that could begin to honor the losses on all of the sides, to begin building a bridge of trust and understanding through clearing landmines and bombs from the most war-torn area of the country. Today, 21 years later, though it seemed impossible, strong bridges of trust have been built between Vietnamese and American people. And nearly 100,000 landmines and bombs have been cleared in Quang Tri province. Let's each take a moment to reflect on the bridges we would like to build in our own lives and in our community as we listen to the words of St. Francis of Assisi, who was born in 1181 AD. Lord, make me an instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, let me bring pardon. And where there is doubt, true faith in you. O divine master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Today, we offer our prayers for families in every country of the world for their safety and their well-being. Amen.
Well, we're going to jump into the short program, and to lead it off is Jan Curley. Jan's a nine-year Rotarian. She is an avid boater, a dog lover, a very proud grandma, and she's here today because she's got the inside line on someone who's an expert on movies. So I'm turning it over to you, Jan, and thank you for your help today.
She's back. So I am very excited today to introduce our short speaker. Just around the corner are the Oscars, where there's going to be a show on TV next week. And I am fortunate enough to know this gentleman here, who is Brian Tybel. He's with Como Radio and News, Como Radio News TV. And he is going to talk to us about what's new, the new movies that have been out this year, what's going to be happening at the Oscars, what we should look for, who we should be impressed with, not impressed with, and just give us kind of his take on the Oscars. Brian is one of the most, is the most listened to movie critic in the Pacific Northwest. And He grew up in Tacoma, Washington. He's a graduate of Washington State University. No booze from the Huskies, please. And I've known, Brian and I kind of bonded over our love of movies, and this was many, many years ago. So I still, to this day, look to him to give me advice on what movies to see. So it is my pleasure to introduce Brian, the movie guy. And I would also like to tell you that Brian is my son and and the father of my three wonderful grandsons. So let's hear about the movies from Brian.
Thanks, Mom. This is almost too high. Yeah, thanks for having me. This is awesome. Thank you, guys. I hope I'm not going to... They said there was going to be a movie expert up here, so when that person arrives, I'll step down. It's fun. This is... People ask me... The number one question I get is probably, how do you do it? And that doesn't have anything to do with movies. It has to do with the fact that I have three boys at home. I ask my wife every night, how do we do that? What do we do next? I take them to a lot of movies. I take my wife to movies. My whole approach to reviewing the roughly 150 films I see each year, which is a staggering number, especially when you've got a family at home, is that I take my family, I take my wife, I take my kids, just to get everybody's input. I feel like there's a lot of critics out there, and not to knock the way anybody approaches stuff. I have learned, though, that people want the gist. They want the elevator review. They want to say, hey, what did you think of La La Land? And sometimes they just want a letter grade. Sometimes they want a little bit more in depth, and I'll give that, but it's gotta be that elevator pitch or you're gonna lose that person. So if I can do that and say, my wife loved it, my kids, you know, any given movie, I think it's more valuable to the person that's listening, so they can kind of plan their weekend or what they're gonna do around that. So with that, with the Oscars coming out next week, next Sunday, well, I'm going to go over a few movies here. I'm used to having 90 seconds to do that on the radio each week with Star and Como and KVI Radio. I'm also in Denver and Billings, Montana, a couple other places, but I'm used to 90 seconds. So they're going to give me a little bit more time today. I have the clicker right here, which I thought was a shaver at first. It's not. Let's get right into, I don't even know where I'm supposed to be pointing it, sorry. I was going to start first by kind of telling you where I where I come from, where I stand in terms of movies. You know, a lot of critics like the artsy stuff, and the artsy stuff, like the movie that you mentioned earlier, Sold. I mean, that's Sold. That stuff is incredible and great to have in cinema. A lot of people don't see those movies. I try to see, because I'm on radio and I've got a larger audience, roughly a million people a week, I try and go for the bigger stuff. When I see something like Sold or a movie that's smaller, I definitely try and get that out. But if I went to too many screenings per week, my wife would put a pillow over my face in my sleep. So I don't do that. So just to give you an idea where I stand in terms of 2006, my number one movie of the year was La La Land. I think if you haven't seen it yet and you've seen it now with all the hype, it's gonna have trouble living up to that hype. But it's a great movie. You can kind of look down the list. There's some of those were nominated for Best Picture, so we're going to get to those in just a second. My kids saw that I put Star Wars, the new Star Wars movie, at number 10, and they asked me why I didn't like it. I had to explain to them it's still in my top 10. That was their number one movie of the year. But that kind of gives you a quick idea. And if you, the other question I get all the time is, what do I need to see? There's some stuff on there, but as we go through the Oscars, I'm going to skip over that. There's, get right to it. Best Supporting Actress. A lot of these movies are still in theaters right now. You've got Fences, you've got Hidden Figures, which is in theaters right now. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. It's a great movie for the entire family. It's about NASA and the African-American women work pool that worked at NASA at that time. Just a wonderful story, and you can engage with your kids about it too. My kids had all sorts of questions. Lion, which is the story of a young boy who accidentally gets on a train, an empty train in India, falls asleep, wakes up 2,000 miles from home, and it's about his journey trying to find his way back home. If you don't cry at the end of that movie, you probably don't have a soul. It really goes for the jugular in terms of that. Next up, we have Manchester by the Sea, and then we have a movie about three phases of a young boy's life in Florida as he's trying to kind of find his identity in the movie Moonlight. You look at all these performances, great performances from all five of these actresses. If you've seen Fences, you'll know why Viola Davis is one of the easy locks for Best Supporting Actress. She is so phenomenal, along with Denzel Washington. She's so phenomenal in this movie. So if you're gonna be doing a pool or anything, that is my pick, Viola Davis. And I highly recommend, I can't recommend it enough. Fences is a fantastic movie. Next up, we have Best Actor. Some of these movies we mentioned before. One is Fences is in there again, Denzel Washington. We've got Hacksaw Ridge, directed by Mel Gibson. That's Andrew Garfield is the actor in that. Ryan Gosling for the movie La La Land. And then Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea. And Viggo Mortensen for this wonderful movie that was actually filmed in the Northwest. I think he's going to be happy just to be nominated. This one, Casey Affleck has won almost every single award up until recently. Denzel Washington is starting to kind of come on late in the game. I've seen all these movies because that's my job. Pound for pound, I think Denzel gives the better performance. It's more layered, it's more nuanced. I got a thumbs up. We have signals down here in case I'm right or wrong, so I'm one for one. Both great movies, two for two actually. Manchester by the Sea is good, it's not very uplifting, neither is Fences. But Casey Affleck's very good. It's just kind of a one-note performance where Denzel, who's good all the time, this is one of his best performances. He has so many different layers. You like him, you hate him, you understand him, you don't see where he's coming from. It's just a tremendous performance from both him and Viola Davis. Next up, oh yeah, so that's my pick. So those are the two. I'm going with Denzel for Best Actor. Best Actress, I'll start moving along here. We have Isabelle Huppert for a foreign film called Elle. Very powerful movie about a rape and how a woman deals with that. She's actually recently has won some awards, kind of came out of nowhere. We have, I'm trying to see my sheet here, I can barely see it. We have Natalie Portman for Jackie, who after I saw that movie about Jackie Onassis, I was like, oh my gosh, there's no way this woman's not gonna win. La La Land, though, Emma Stone, I didn't mention this earlier, La La Land was nominated for 14 Academy Awards, which is tied for the record with Titanic and All About Eve. So there's three movies that have gotten 14 nominations. La La Land's one of them. I think that Emma Stone is going to get wrapped up in a lot of the awards that movie's going to win come Oscar night, and I think she's going to come out the victor. Ruth Negga as well in the movie Loving, kind of a slow movie, a little slow for my taste, but it's a very powerful movie about interracial marriage, and she's fantastic in it. So most of the nominations here are all very, very deserving. I know there's years where I go, oh, that shouldn't be nominated. So I'm going with Emma Stone, Best Supporting Actor. We have Jeff Bridges for the movie Hell or High Water. If you've seen that movie, it's Jeff Bridges. He's always fantastic. Dev Patel plays this young boy in the movie Lion who gets on the train. He plays the young boy as an older boy. We have Lucas Hedges from the movie Manchester by the Sea. We have Marshala Ali for the movie Moonlight. And then we have Michael Shannon for the movie Nocturnal Animals. This one, in addition to Viola Davis for Best Supporting Actress, I think this is the only lock two of the evening. I think this is gonna go to Marshala Ali for Moonlight. He is fantastic in the movie. Also a very good movie. Didn't make my top 10, but it's still very powerful. So I pick him. Best Picture, there's eight nominees. The movie Arrival with Amy Adams, which just came out on DVD Blu-ray yesterday. It's a movie that I liked when I saw it. When I watched it a second time, it's science fiction, but it's not aliens and lasers. It's very heady and hypnotic, and you kind of gotta, it's slow moving, but you gotta roll with it, and it's got a tremendous payoff. Amy Adams should have been nominated, but wasn't for some reason. She's very good in the movie. I highly recommend you watch it twice. That second time, it'll all come together and work for you. Fences was nominated, Hacksaw Ridge, directed by Mel Gibson, Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, Moonlight, La La Land, Manchester by the Sea, and Lion. So most of these movies we've seen in the other categories. Out of those nine nominees, Arrival, Hell or High Water, La La Land, and Fences almost made my top 10. Three of those movies made my top 10, so there's some great choices. With 14 nominations, I think it's hard to ignore the fact that La La Land is probably gonna win. It was my number one movie of the year. It is fantastic. Do I get a thumbs up or no? Oh, no thumbs up, thumbs down, shoot. If you can get behind that musical vibe, it should work for you, but again, there's been so much hype and it's won so much up to this point, it's gonna be tough to manage, you know, to keep up with the expectations you go in with at this point. So La La Land is going to win, I think. Out of those, you get five nominees for Best Director. Out of those movies, these are the five that got their Best Director nominated. Damien Chazelle, who directed La La, I know I'm singing the La La Land praises right now. Damien Chazelle is going to walk away with the Best Director prize. And if you remember him, this is his second movie. His first one was a couple years ago, a movie called Whiplash, about a kid going to prestigious drum music school, one of my favorites. And then finally, these are the movies that are nominated for Best Picture, where you can see them. Most of them are out on DVD, or a couple of DVD Blu-ray. There's some still in theaters, but I highly recommend each and every one of them. There's not one here I could disagree with in terms of being nominated. They're all very powerful pictures, so that is all I have, and that's me. You can listen to me on every Friday. I'll be rambling on like this, but only 90 seconds, on Como, Star, and KVI Radio. So thanks for having me.
Well, last year, when I was thinking about what contemporary topics I wanted to address this year, there were four I wanted to include: gender identity, guns in America, immigration, and the Muslim experience in our country. Today, we're going to tackle immigration. And when I thought about this and how to frame a program, I turned to our past president, Paul Ishii, for some guidance, and he's been great. I was really inspired during Paul's year when he served as club president, 2012 to 2013, the compelling programming that he delivered to our club that year. So, Paul, you were an inspiration from that year to me. So I knew Paul would tee up expertise, deliver on the facts, help us answer the key questions, and above all, let us come away with more understanding about this complicated topic, which seems to be more complicated than ever. So I'm turning it over to you, Paul. Thank you for all you do for our club, and in particular, for your help with today's program on immigration.
Thank you, President Kathy. When immigration executive orders make the headlines, it gets me nervous. My grandparents came to Seattle in the early 1900s. My parents were born in Seattle. Then on February 19, 1942, 75 years ago, Executive Order 9066 incarcerated over 100,000 Japanese Americans into internment camps without any due process. They were considered threats. No joke, camping was never a favorite pastime for our family. They had enough to last a lifetime. One thing we all have in common in this room is that long ago, our families came from other countries to settle here, and our ancestors had to figure it out to get one of these, legal proof of U.S. citizenship. It says on the first page, the Secretary of State of the United States of America hereby requests all whom it may concern to permit the citizen of the United States named herein to pass without delay or hindrance and in case of need to give all lawful aid and protection. Today's program is divine intervention. The timing could not be better. It's important for all of us to get a fresh perspective on this current headline called immigration. Today, Joel Paget and Jorge Barron will be our presenters. We have planned to have ample time for Q&A so that members can ask some thoughtful questions. I have the distinct pleasure to introduce Joel Paget, an esteemed member of our club. Joel is a senior member of the immigration group at Ryan Swanson in Cleveland. He has over 35 years of immigration experience and takes great pride in helping bring the best and brightest into the United States. His immigration practice includes assisting immigrants to obtain visas, permanent residence, citizenship, and naturalization in the United States. Joel received his law degree from the University of Washington. Joel, the podium is yours.
Thank you, Paul. Everyone in this room has a story about how you or your ancestors came to the United States. My great-grandfather, Charles Paget, came from England and landed in Kalamazoo, Michigan. My mother's ancestor, Nicholas Hathaway, landed in Massachusetts in 1648, and no one asked for a passport when he came. I'm going to take you to 1880 and just take a quick snapshot. We had basically 50 million people, of which 13% were first-generation immigrants. That means 6.7 immigrants. On the West Coast, it was basically made up of people from China. And then you had New Mexico and Texas and Arizona was Mexican. Basically, the middle of America and the East Coast was German and Irish. And Florida was Cuban, first immigrants. Now, you go to fast forward to 2010, 31 states, the dominant first-generation immigrants are Mexican, 31 states. Indians are basically the first in dominance in Massachusetts. And Florida, we have the Cubans, okay? Today in America, we allow about 1 million immigrants into the United States each year. And I thought I'd have you sort of participate in showing you where those immigrants come from. So all of you that are at the tables marked immediate relatives, stand up. I want you to stand up. Okay, this represents about 40% of the 1 million-plus immigrant visas. These are parents of U.S. citizens, spouses of U.S. citizens, and children under 21 of U.S. citizens, okay? And you basically have a right to come, and you're in here probably within a year or two at most. Now, thank goodness we have a court order that allows you from the seven countries to get here if you happen to have a visa that was issued just after the executive order. So you can sit down, okay? Now, family-based one. We have a table out there that's family-based one. This is unmarried sons and daughters. Okay, and you're lucky to be here right now because your parent sponsored you 6 years ago, and now you're able to finally get your visa, except if you're from the Philippines, it's 11 years ago, and if you're from Mexico, it's 21 years ago that your parent actually filed the petition to get you here. Okay, that's family-based one. Family-based two, okay? These are spouses and children of lawful permanent residents. Okay, and also unmarried sons and daughters of lawful permanent residents. And the unmarried sons and daughters, if you're from the Philippines, it's going to be your parent filed 10 years ago. If you're from Mexico, it was 20 years ago that your parent filed for you. So if you were basically 20 years old, you're probably 40 now by the time you got in here. Okay, family-based three. Okay, you can sit down. Family-based three should be out there. Any family-based three? Look at your table card. Okay. Okay, family-based three. These people should not be let in the United States because they can't read. Okay. Now, these are married sons and daughters of U.S. citizens. So they got married, and their sons and daughters, that means they're 21 or older. And this distinction there is taken 11 years after that petition is filed by the parent to get the person here. But if you're from Mexico or the Philippines, it's basically 22 years. Okay, so the parent filed the petition, the child waited 22 years, and now they're here today, okay? Family-based four. We got a family-based four down front here, okay? These are brothers and sisters of U.S. citizens, okay? And now, they are waiting 13 years. Their parent filed 13 years ago, except for India, which would be basically 12 years ago. Okay, so you can sit down, okay? Now, family, the ones that were family-based, one, two, three, and four, are about 20% of the visas that we give out. So the immediate relatives take about 40%. This last group takes about 20%, and that is of the total. What is interesting is that there are backed up, right now, 4.2 million petitions that are pending, okay? And 1.3 million of those are from Mexico that are just waiting for that visa number to come up. That's kind of how it stacks up. Okay, employment-based one, gotta move on quickly. Employment-based one, okay, these are the extraordinary aliens. I picked the table that represents my firm. This is about half of the immigration group. They are extraordinary, okay? These are the Nobel Peace Prize people, the researchers, the scientists, the kind of people you wanna invite for dinner. Okay, sit down, okay. Employment-based two, okay? These are people with professional degrees, usually need a labor certification, but they at least have a master's degree. The only problem is if you're from China or from India, you got a problem because you've been waiting 4 years in the case of China and probably be over 8 years if you're from India. That's how long you've been waiting. Okay, employment-based three. okay? These are people that are professionals with a college degree, or they're skilled workers, and that, I'm gonna skip my slides, I think. What have we got, ones? Yeah, I haven't been doing the slides. But they've been basically, this group, China, if you're from China, born in China, you got 10 years that you've been waiting, India 12, and the Philippines 5. So these are people with college degrees where a job is available, but they gotta wait for their card to do that. Okay, now, employment base 4, out there somewhere. Religious workers, okay? Basically based on your religious organization, in El Salvador and Mexico are backed up 2 years, but otherwise you got a visa to come in. Employment based 5, this is your investor visa. Okay, these are guys with the big bucks, $500,000, $1 million, and they got 10 employees, but there's only about 10,000 visas, and China is backed up now 2 years on that one. Now we have asylees and refugees. There's a table over there somewhere. All right, it filled in. Now this is basically refugees, 85,000, 25,000 asylees, but you notice that President Trump has cut the refugees basically in half, and none from Syria, thank you very much. So refugees can hold for a second. Diversity lottery out there somewhere, it's about 5%, but they tried to spread out the visas from country to countries that weren't represented normally. That's once a year, it's a lottery. But people win it, it's better than the Reader's Digest lottery. Okay, others, there's an others table out there somewhere, so we got the VAWA and U visas. Victims of crime, victim of domestic violence, but basically you're limited in numbers, but that is available. They do give those out each year. Okay, that covers, that's a million visas, immediate relatives, relatives of family, and then you got your employment based 1, 2, 3, 4, and you got asylees, refugees, and other. And that makes up our million that come in legally every year. Okay, now, I'm gonna introduce Jorge Barón, okay? He is the executive director of Northwest Immigrant Rights Project, which is the premier organization, both in the Northwest and probably the nation, of representing people that are unrepresented, can't afford an attorney, and they need help. He has basically 68 staff members and a $6.5 million budget. He is an immigrant from Bogota, Colombia. Came here at the age of 13, went to Duke undergrad, he went to Yale Law School. He's been the director here 8 years and has done a remarkable job. And he's gonna lead us in the rest of the discussion about immigrants.
Thank you, Joel, and thank you everybody for being here and for inviting me to talk today. I wanna acknowledge, immigration is a controversial subject, and so I want to appreciate the fact that all of you are here to discuss this, because I think one of the problems that we have with immigration policy actually is the fact that people get tense about it. And so I think I want to acknowledge that, because I think it's the reason that I think people feel strongly about it is because it's a fundamental question. It's talking about who the people in our country are going to be, and that's a pretty weighty conversation. One of the things that I get concerned about, though, is that precisely because there's so much intensity on the subject, a lot of folks, and particularly folks kind of in the middle of this issue, get afraid to talk about it because it's so intense. And so I really want to commend you for having this discussion, and I look forward to the Q&A to have a thoughtful conversation, because there's a lot of different perspectives. And one of the things that I want to acknowledge is that I'm talking to you from my perspective, working with people in the immigration system, particularly with people who are undocumented, and I'll talk about that more in a minute. And so that's where my perspective comes from. I want to talk with some things that I hear frequently that people tell me, questions that come up that I perceive as myths. And I want to acknowledge that there's going to be different perspectives, and I'll try to address that, but I just wanted to start off with talking about some things that I hear in the debate that I want to make sure that we focus some and talk about. So the first one is that we hear about is, immigrants lead to higher crime rates. And I want to be very clear that what I'm saying here, what I'm talking about, is not that, an immigrant may commit a crime, because we are human beings and some of us unfortunately do break the law. But I think the issue is about whether immigrants cause higher crime rates than people who are born in the United States. And I want to just flag for you that the evidence is very strongly that that is not the case. And so they've looked at this in a number of different ways. They've analyzed data about people who are born outside the United States and compare them to people who are born in the United States. And the evidence is that people who are born outside of the United States, who are here in the United States, are 4.3 times less likely to be in jail if you control for age and all the other factors than people who are born here. So I'm not trying to say that folks who are born in the United States are more dangerous than people who are immigrants, but I'm just saying statistically speaking, y'all are more likely to end up in jail than I am. All right. So we'll just move on with that. I mean, there's a lot of other things that I could talk about, I'm trying to go quick. The other one, and I was just talking to somebody about this issue, undocumented people don't pay taxes. There's definitely true that a lot of people who are undocumented are working without authorization, and so they're working under the table. But in fact, a lot of people are actually in the system. They're working with they've made up Social Security number, and so they're actually in the system. And so the evidence is actually that people pay, on average in a year, over $13 billion in payroll taxes. Because basically what happens is that the employer deducts that money from their paycheck, like they do for many of us, and then they send it to the Social Security Administration. Now, for the rest of us that are authorized, that have a valid Social Security number, that goes into our Social Security account. But when it comes and the number doesn't match up, the Social Security doesn't send the money back. They keep it, and they're like, well, just put it aside in this fund, and that helps actually pay for Social Security benefits for other people, because undocumented people are actually not eligible for Social Security benefits. And also, obviously state taxes. I mean, I don't know if anybody here has actually been asked for their passport or their documentation when you go buy something at the store, but obviously everybody's paying sales taxes, so that's definitely one way to contribute. Now, I want to flag again, there's an issue about the benefits that people might receive or the costs, but I'm just flagging the issue of taxes because that's one that I hear frequently. The other issue is, that immigrants take jobs from Americans, and that's obviously something that comes up a lot in the debate. And I think this one's a complicated issue because it's not, it's not a clear-cut answer. It depends on how you look at it, and I think that the evidence, if you look at the issue on the aggregate, the overall situation is that immigration, many analyses have been done that in terms of the whole economy, it definitely increases the total number of jobs that people have had. And I mean, if you think about it, if we had kept the same number of people that we had, back in 1787, if we hadn't grown through immigration, then we'd still be at 3 million jobs, right? It just makes sense that more people are going to create more jobs. There are displacement. It definitely is an issue of displacement for some populations, but ironically, the people who get displaced the most are actually more recent immigrants who perhaps suffer some consequences from people who are coming after them. So the other thing that I wanted to talk about is, Joel talked a lot about sort of our legal immigration system and people who have the opportunity to come and get green cards like I did when I was came to the United States. But there's a large number of people who are undocumented in the country. And I first want to just talk a little bit about the label of undocumented immigrant. I want to acknowledge that when you hear about the debate, a lot of folks use other labels, illegal immigrant, illegal. And I want to explain and acknowledge why I use the term undocumented immigrant. That's for two reasons, because I think one of the foundations of this country was that every human being has basic human rights. And so I think I find it a little bit problematic to call somebody who's outside the law, because that's actually not what our Constitution talks about. Our Constitution talks about persons, so everybody's entitled to some basic human protections. But also, as an immigration attorney, I find that a lot of people who are currently without permission actually qualify for some way to obtain immigration status. So, they just haven't actually been able to get the documentation. I'll talk about some of those barriers in a minute. So that's why I use the term undocumented. So there's the estimates are around 11 million people in the country, about 234,000, although the estimates are kind of rough on here in Washington State. And I think people ask me the question of, like, why is it, you know, ways that we have such a large undocumented population. And I think really some of the changes that we've made to our immigration policy have made it actually more difficult for people to legalize their status. I mean, Joel talked a little bit about the changes. You know, there used to be no restrictions on immigration for the first half of our history as a country, so there was really no way to come illegally because there were just simply no restrictions, and some of the restrictions that were placed were based on ethnicities like the Chinese Exclusion Act. But it's been more recently, particularly since 96, that we've made it much more difficult for people to actually legalize their status once they're here. And I could talk for hours literally about that topic, so I'm not gonna get there. But there's also some of our policies actually have made it so that there used to be a lot of back and forth migration. And actually some of the border enforcement policies have actually made it so that people have decided instead of doing this back and forth that they used to do, to just stay here because it's become much more expensive to actually travel back and forth like they used to do several years ago. The one thing that I wanted to emphasize, if you take nothing away from my presentation, and I think in terms of the perspective that we have about this issue is, you know, let's just remember when I talk about all these numbers that we're talking about human beings. I think that for us, it's very important when we talk about sort of federal policy and everything, you know, ultimately we're talking about people who are in the community already. Many of them are connected in different ways. They're going to school here. Their children are going to school. They're working with us. They're, you know, going to school with us. And, you know, 87% of children with immigrant parents are U.S. citizens. So they're people who have permission to be here and authorized to be here. And we have a significant population that is also who has lawful status. So I think when there's a lot of focus on undocumented population, we frequently miss that. What are we gonna see in terms of changes? Obviously, I think there's gonna be a lot of more immigration enforcement, and when they're the new administration, we have the fourth largest immigration detention center here in the country, in the Tacoma area, where people are held pending deportation hearings, and this is where the decision is made as to whether they're going to be allowed to stay in the country or not. So it's already at pretty high capacity, over 1,500 people as we speak today are in the detention center right now. And one of the challenges that we have with people in that situation is that even though they have this courtroom that they go to, they don't have the right to an appointed attorney like they would in a criminal case. So if they go there and they don't have the ability to hire a private attorney, and they're going to have to represent themselves unless they can get assistance from one of the nonprofit agents or volunteer attorney, and our capacity is pretty limited. So about 92% of people who go through deportation hearings in Tacoma are not going to have an attorney represent them in their case, which makes the process really, in our view, very unfair. I'm going to pause here because I really want to leave the time for questions, but I appreciate the opportunity to talk to all of you. Thank you.
Do we have one?
Question. Here we go.
Yesterday I read about they were immigration officers and pick up somebody from Seattle, and that person doesn't have any criminal background, and it supposed to be stay here legally. Does the immigration officer have a right to do that? If not, because Donald Trump's order, and what is the validity of Donald Trump's order on this?
So the immigration officer needs to have some reason to suspect that the person's here without status, right? So they can't just look at me and say, well, my name is Jorge, and so I'm gonna be suspicious of you. They need to have some evidence. And unfortunately, what we do see is that sometimes they'll be coming looking for somebody that they know about, because maybe that person had a prior deportation order, and then they start questioning other people around. And those people have the right not to disclose any information, but sometimes they don't know that, and so they'll admit that they don't have valid status right now. And that does give them give the officer, you know, cause to detain them. I think one of the changes that we've seen that President Obama had sort of prioritized people who actually had a criminal record, and or more significant criminal record, and he directed people, you know, don't do the roundups of other people who are around the community. Unfortunately, that, from our perspective, that's something that the Trump administration has said, you know, is going to now, they're going to be able to detain other folks who they encounter during those instances. And so we are expecting that we're going to have a big increase in the number of that. Now, the legality, I think the question for me is, why did they start questioning somebody, right? If they're doing it only based on ethnicity, that is clearly unconstitutional, and we would challenge that because we don't think people should be profiled in that way.
Question here.
Okay. Yes, can you tell me what a person such as myself who is sympathetic to undocumented people might do today?
Go ahead.
So I think one thing that is important, if that's how you feel, and I think, frankly, however you feel about the immigration system, is, you know, talk to your representatives, talk to the federal representatives. I know that sounds like, you know, what everybody says, but I think that's how they make decisions on how to support it. And frankly, I know, for example, Senator Cantwell and Senator Murray have been supportive of more pro-immigrant policies, but they tell me, folks from their staff will tell me, well, you know, when I vote in favor of a pro-immigrant policy, I get tons of calls from people who are against it. They hear from them very loud and clear, but I don't hear as much from the people who think that that's the right policy. And so if they are taking a step that you agree with, then, you know, I think oftentimes it's kind of human nature to only complain when somebody does something wrong. But if something does something that you are supportive of, or if you want them to go in something, even if you think that's the way they're going to vote anyway, I think it's important to make your voice heard.
Yeah. That's true for the Congress people as well. I mean, Congressman Reichert and Delbani, all of them want to hear your story, hear what your concern is, but usually ahead of time, that would help.
And I think they're used to hearing from, like, the immigrant rights groups, but if they're hearing from other folks in the community, I think that that makes a big difference, too.
Question over here.
So over the weekend, there was a young man in Seattle who was picked up by ICE who has DACA status, deferred action for childhood arrivals. And as I understand it, he is suing the federal government, but I don't know enough details about the particular case. I do wonder, does this indicate a shift in federal policy towards DACA immigrants, and what the potential issues might be in that case?
So yes, you're correct. And just to make sure that everybody understands, one of the things that I didn't talk about is that people who came to the United States at a very young age currently don't have a pathway necessarily to be able to get legal status. Just the fact that, as this young man did, came when he was 7 years old and has lived here most of his life, isn't one of the criteria, right? We talked about all the different ways. You notice that one of the ways is not, I've lived here since I was seven, right? And so there is currently no pathway under our legislation. There's been a proposal in Congress called the DREAM Act for many years, but it's a proposal only. It has never been enacted into law. So President Obama created the program that you referenced in 2012 and gave a temporary deferral of deportation for undocumented youth. There's 750,000 nationally and over 17,000 here in Washington State who are in this program, and they basically get a temporary notice that they're not going to be deported and they're going to get a work permit. And this case that you referenced is something that happened late last week, because immigration came to detain actually his dad, and then they also detained this young man who had, even though he showed them and he had the DACA permit. So we're actually involved in that case, and I can say that we're trying to get answers from immigration about why he was detained. We don't feel like, if the government already told him they're not going to deport him, it's unfair to now kind of pull the plug under him, pull the rug under him. So we're fighting that right now as we speak. There's a court hearing on Friday, and we're hoping to get more information about what it is. I don't think it's a question of the fact that the DACA program is going away, but we're concerned about what it means.
Over here.
No one there.
So my question would be, a million people seems like just an arbitrary number of visas, and there's clearly a huge backlog of people that want to come to America. What's a reasonable number that the U.S. could legitimately absorb in any given year?
I'll make one comment on that. You know, even with the 11 million or so that are out of status, undocumented at this point, that's basically about 3% of our population. We're over 300 million. That's less than 3%, you know, it's less than a percent or two. I mean, it's a single digit. I'm basically, if you talk to me, I'm for Library Day. I don't know if any of you kept books from the library and didn't take them back, but then they announced that you can all come back and give your book and no questions asked. So I'm basically, every 20 years, you sort of need this leveling out of Library Day. Ronald Reagan did it in 1986. He opened it up to 6 million people that were here undocumented, at least. And so that sort of cleaned the table at that point. Here we are after how many years? That's 20. 30 years later, we're back to where we need another Library Day. And I think we can absorb them. I mean, the short answer to your question is, that's a small number, really, when you look at it.
Question over here.
Yeah, we've heard a lot about the role of religion in immigration policy, and this seems to be, right now, a very critical issue. Can you give us a little perspective on that and what role it's played over history? And we think of Catholicism and its role, how it's been perceived, and now Islam.
Boy, you want to take first shot?
Well, so I will say, you know, we're both like, oh, I don't know, that's a tough one. You know, I think that I'll speak particularly to what's happening right now, because I think that, you know, and I want to sort of acknowledge we're involved right now, our organization is involved in a lawsuit against the federal government precisely on the travel ban. And certainly one of the claims that we've made in that is that we think it is based on religion. I mean, they try to make it in terms of nationality, but, you know, I think the president was very clear, and I will give him credit for the fact that he's fulfilling his campaign promises, and he said very clearly that that's what he intended to do. And I think his advisors told him you can't say that it's based on religion, but even the Ninth Circuit judges unanimously found that there was a serious question as to that. And I do think that's problematic, because I think from my perspective as an immigrant, I think one of the things that make this country great, I hate to use that label, but is the fact that we don't base it based on ethnicity or religion. I mean, I think at least that's our aspiration, right? And I think Eric Liu, who does a lot of writing about citizenship, you know, he's talked about the fact that, you know, you can make Chinese an American, but you can't make an American a Chinese. Like, other countries don't think of it the way that we've thought about it. And I think that's really a very important thing to say. It doesn't matter your religion or what you look like, you can be an American. And I'm afraid that these policies are undermining that message.
Last question from Bill Weisfield.
Can you tell us very quickly, in the interest of time, what happens at the other end? We put somebody on a plane, a train, or a car. What happens when they arrive wherever we send them?
Well, I can tell you what happens. So the way that it works right here regionally, people every week at the Northwest Detention Center, there's people who are taken to a Boeing field. The flights usually leave early in the morning. On Tuesday mornings, for example, there's flights from a federal agency. It's like a little airline that we have. They fly people down to the southern border. People from Mexico are just bussed over across the border. People who are from Central America, for example, will board another flight that will take him to El Salvador or Honduras. Folks from other countries tend to be flown just commercially. And they're just let off. And, you know, we can have people who've lived here for 20, 25 years, and they got to start a new life. They might have not seen, you know, the country that they've been at. Some people don't even speak the language anymore, because that's the reality.
I think that was the last. Was that the last question? Wrap it up. I think lovely questions. We'd love to see you at Triple Door tomorrow night, because Jorge and I both said we're going to carve that out of our schedules and we'll take on all questions. But my thought is that we're all involved in this, and I don't know of anybody here that has not touched on this with help, that maybe you had a house cleaner or a nanny or somebody that did your lawn or whatever, and they asked for cash and you paid them. I mean, even the Secretary of Labor nominee by Donald Trump has been cited for hiring illegals, and some of the Democrat nominees for the Supreme Court have withdrawn their names because of that. But I think in looking around this room, you don't have to raise your hand, but I think you've probably known or been involved with this, and you've all benefited from undocuments, whether it be the cheaper hotel rate, better, cheaper meal, your lawn done, whatever it is, you've benefited by it. So be involved in this and trying to help solve this issue. Because you basically got, almost a semi-slavery going on here of people working at the lowest margins in our society, and they need somehow to have that ceiling taken away.
Well, and again, thank you for being involved. And I think the one thing that I would just reinforce is please stay engaged. I mean, go beyond today and get involved. Even if you disagree with the perspective that I've shared, you know, get to learn more and engage and realize that, as Joel mentioned, these are neighbors that are here in our community. And whatever you think the policy should be, I think you should make that known and engage and think about the topic, because it's just too important for us not to engage in this conversation in a respectful manner. I hope many of you are able to participate in the event tomorrow, but there's also other opportunities for you to be engaged in the conversation in the future. So thank you so much.
Well, my call to action is going to be quick today. Yesterday was Valentine's Day, but I'm going to ask you to consider extending it one more day and making a point to tell someone you care about them, that you love them. Please go tell somebody you love them. We're adjourned until next week.